two-part answer. Part one, it's always mixed. Whether people think of it or want it or like it, it's always mixed. You are always engaged in changes in the society, and you might imagine you control how they will develop, but you don't. So that you can't even put a label reform and revolution most of the time, because we have countless examples of people who were engaged in what in retrospect we would call reform, but it turned out to be revolutionary. And just as many examples of people who were very sure that what they were doing was revolutionary, but it turned out that it was a reform. So the clarity is fake. We don't have that clarity. So the bottom line is, we all work for reforms. Some of us see them as reforms and are satisfied. Others of us see them as reforms and are dissatisfied because we want more. That's all the difference. It's an open question which side will have its outcome as it wishes. It's often one, it's sometimes the other. Here's my second point. And here I'm relying on the United States experience. In the 1930s was the last time that capitalism was challenged in a fundamental way here in the United States. And it really was challenged, much more than we have seen since the crash of 2008. You had a massive movement from below in the United States, starting in 1929 and building right over into World War II, roughly 1929, 1941. That movement from below had as its largest component something called the CIO, the Congress of Industrial Organizations. It was the greatest mobilization of people joining labor unions that America had ever seen. And we've never had it again. It is absolutely unique. Millions of people who had never been in a union before, who came from families where their parents had never been in a union before, joined actively in a union movement, transformed the country. That union movement, CIO, was allied to two different socialist parties, a moderate socialist party and a Trotskyist socialist party, and finally to the American Communist Party. And despite their differences, the communists, the two socialists, and the CIO worked together very effectively. And they were a powerful force. Why is this important? Because that debate you speak of was very active in them. The CIO tended to be what we would now call reformist. The communists tended to be revolutionary. And the Trotskyists and the socialists, somewhere in between, or if you like, the Trotskyists revolutionary too. I don't want to get in. It doesn't matter for the point I'm making here. The debate then was reform or revolution. The CIO, the communists and the socialists, went to the president, Roosevelt, and said, you must do for the mass of people what they need to get through this terrible depression, or we will vote you out of office, and we will have a revolution in this country. The socialists and the communists particularly focused on, let's have a revolution in this country. And remember, we're talking the early 30s. That's a very short time from what had happened in Russia in 1917. So it was very alive as a possibility. And the socialists, the Trotskyists at least, and the communists had massive support, tens if not hundreds of thousands. So they were in a position that the president understood he was talking with real power. The president took them seriously, and he went back to the business community, the rich. He was one of them anyway. He told them about what the CIO, socialists and communists had demanded. And he said that he agreed, you have to meet this demand. And he said to the business and the rich, if you don't give me the money to help them, they will make a revolution and you won't have any money to give anybody. I mean, to be blunt, they didn't say it in those words, but that was the message. So he went back. He got it. He split them. Half the business and rich hated Roosevelt. The other half agreed. They were afraid. So they said, okay, we'll give you the money. So Roosevelt went back to the socialists, communists, and unions. And he said to them, and here's the crucial thing. I will give you, to use now our language, I will give you reform. But you have to give up all that crap about revolution. No revolution. Because the communists had talked about it, and Trotskyites had talked about it, and so on. They bought this deal. The communists did, the socialists did. Not, it wasn't unanimous. There were critics and dissenters. But in general, they bought the deal. And Roosevelt was good. He created Social Security. He created the unemployment compensation. He passed the first minimum wage. And he created 15 million jobs working for the government for unemployed people. It was way more reform than they had even expected. But in the debate between the reformers and the revolutionaries, the revolutionaries lost. The reformers won. And we got the New Deal. So the debate was had. The debate was furious. It lasted some years. And a decision was made in the political moment. The 50 years since then have been a demonstration, if you ever needed it, of what the difference between revolution and reform is. A reform changes the forms, but it doesn't change the basic structure. Roosevelt never took from the capitalists their position as the owners and directors of capitalist industry. So immediately at the end of World War II, with the death of Roosevelt, the business community and the wealthy took their positions, which had never been taken from them. And they used it to systematically, over the last 50 years, not only take back most of the reforms, make the minimum wage a laughingstock. The minimum wage in this country is $7.35 an hour, lower than it is almost anywhere else. I mean, it is horrible. Unemployment compensation is a joke. Social Security is being cut back all the time. And we just went through the second worst crash of capitalism, and there wasn't even a discussion of a public employment program compared to what we did last time. So they have been successful. Not only that, they used their money and their power to destroy the American left, to demonize the communists and wreck that organization, to do the same with the socialists, and then to spend 50 years crushing the CIO, which they have done. Today in the United States, in the private sector, 6.3% of workers are members of or represented by a trade union. The other 93%+ are not. It used to be 1/3 were union members. There you have it. So for me, the debate between reformers and revolutionaries had the bad luck of actually being put to the test in this country for the last 75 years. The verdict is clear. You can't make the reformist mistake again. If you don't transform the workplace, if you don't deprive that tiny minority that are the major shareholders and the boards of directors of corporations of their power and their wealth, any reform you pass will be vulnerable and from everything we know, will be undone as soon as you pass it into law. So for me, to be summary, you have to be a revolutionary because we tried reform in this country. We gave it everything we had as the American left. It didn't work. That's where we are. And if we don't learn from that lesson, we will be condemned to repeat it the next time around. Revolution turns out to be quite close to reform. And in this way, only revolution makes your reform durable. So if you're committed to the reform, you kind of have to be a revolutionary.